Hey guys, so if you're new here, or if you're not, if you want to hear me voice act, head over to our main channel, links down below. And if you don't, this channel's solely for TTS. If you want to know all the details about what's going on, we have a stream up that you can go and watch, but let's just get into the video.
So this is another story from the Paladin DM that also goes by Lord Althory. If you like his work, you should check out his Subscribestar to support him directly, or check out his YouTube channel linked to down below. And with that out of the way, let's get into the story. Kill Team Equinox Chapter 7, The First Wave. The guns roared, and then there was silence. The massive wall defenses reloaded, and behind them, cannons further back in the city began to sound. Across the wall, the boom of fire rippled as the other sectors fired into the seas to support the battleship and submarine fleets. A few moments later, the first shells landed. The front of the Tyranid formation vanished under fire and shrapnel, Xena's body parts flying into the air and crashing into the seas. The guns kept firing, and the Tyranids were blasted to pieces in their hundreds. The once blue seas of Alvara began to turn red. On such a tight position, with artillery already sighted, any other foe would have been utterly destroyed and routed from mass casualties. But these were the Tyranids, and despite the barrage, they were gaining ground, and gaining quickly. Tens of thousands would die on that bridge. It mattered not at all, for millions more were coming. They stretched into the horizon, and their air contingent blotted out the sun like a great storm cloud, advancing with terrible speed. By the God Emperor, how many of them are there? Aitra gasped. Even orcs were not so suicidal, or so numerous. Morn swept the horizon, his augmented eyes able to pick out precise details of the enemy formation. He paused for an instant, his already superhuman intellect combining with his cogitator implants. The enemy possessed a bioform index of 102.35924, and had access to the biomass of the capital hive and at least 400 square miles of agri-world-class ocean. The capital had a population of 6,631,091,040, and the agri-ocean could be considered to be the equivalent of roughly another 1.5 billion depending on season, though exact data was unavailable due to the invasion. The total number of converted bioforms would therefore be approximately 79,436,806. Assuming an initial attack force of average hive cracking ability 7,546,182 and the standard rate of casualty 67.346%, that would be an additional 2,464,130 Tyranids, for a total of 81,900,937 Tyranids active on planet, at least. Of course, not all of them would be attacking here. Assuming that their success at the outpost had warranted double forces compared with the attacks in the other five hives, there would be roughly 27,300,312 Tyranids, with biomass split roughly evenly across land, sea, and air. Approximately 9 million are coming across that bridge. An equivalent force occupies air and sea. This is better than I expected, he replied calmly. Better? What were you expecting? Substantially more human-sized bioforms, and fewer biotitans, or terrestrial biotitans. They appear to have concentrated their super-heavy elements in the air and the sea. Morn replied. Those giant flyers. You'd think they'd be advancing closer to drop a payload. They are not bombardment. Those are carriers for the gargoyles. This is excellent, as is the increased deployment of linebreakers such as Carnifexes. The carriers cannot advance too close to the city without risking attack by the long-range hive guns. Secondly, if the naval elements are successful, they will be able to push forwards and eliminate them. Without their support from the carriers, the enemy air force will fall as much due to attrition as to our guns. As for the enemy heavy elements, they are well suited for storming defensive positions, but are vulnerable to successful urban anti-tank tactics, and will be utterly irrelevant before the might of a Titan. Then all we need to do is hold until the Titans can be deployed. Aitra said, realization dawning. That's what the plan is. Correct. However, even without them, I estimate a 73% chance of victory, with only a 35% casualty rate. The time for talk is past. Here they come. Constantine interrupted, for the enemy had indeed come. In the time that they had been speaking, the swarm had pushed within the firing arc of the largest guns. Secondaries now rained down from the massive gatehouse, shredding the enemy as they began to swarm up the sides of the walls like arachnids. Matriculation gunners. Open fire. The Black Templar ordered an order that resounded across the walls, without the need for vox. The gunners shook the ringing from their ears, pointed their heavy bolters down, and unleashed hell. They had been positioned on the outermost edge of the wall, where Constantine had created an interesting architectural addition. The wall sloped downwards into a slit, which a bolter could be fired through, aiming down the wall at a dizzying angle. It had taken a great deal of work to carefully adjust the floor to allow a gunner to fire down effectively, but the Sons of Dawn were the masters of all manners of fortification. Thus, they unleashed their shells into the swarm as they advanced. The heavy emplacements in the sides of the wall fired as well, reaping a terrible toll among the enemy. Such was the spray and slaughter that none could see through the thick smog of gun smoke, blood, and viscera. But there was no need to be concerned, for the Xenos came upon the gate in such a mass that no matter where one fired, it would find a mark. Counterfire from the aliens smashed into the positions, in such a great array that mere probability dictated that there would be casualties. Still, the men of Alvara held, for this was their home, and they would sell their lives for her dearly. Yet as the inexorable weight of the swarm pushed against the wall, the defenses began to crack. Kynifexes tore through the reinforced wall guns, flying hive tyrants unleashed unspeakable weaponry and terribly psionic power. One by one, the wall guns began to fall away. But this had been known to be inevitable, planned for, and drilled for. As their defenses were overwhelmed, the gunners took up their gear and retreated deeper into the massive wall. As they fled, they detonated hidden charges, engulfing the attacking swarm in flame or casting them off the wall to fall screaming to their deaths. The tyrannids pursued them, pushing into the tight corridors between the outer and inner walls, but the guard were ready for them. The initial explosions bought the gun crew just enough time to leap over a wall, where yet further heavy weapons teams waited. Autocannons whirred into life, filling the corridor with slug rounds and Xeno corpses. They fired without ceasing, until the barrels began to glow hot. Then the third stage of the defenses activated. From above, great quantities of fast-drying permacrete were released into the tunnel, and Abhumanogrin stepped forth from behind the weapons teams. Carrying great slab shields, they blocked the exit, and held out as the tyrannids threw themselves against them desperately. But the great strength of the simple Abhumans was sufficient, for the tunnels were too tight for the strongest tyrannids to push through. Thus the Xeno was denied passage, and sealed within the great wall. Atop that same wall, Constantine knew that the enemy was at hand. Matriculation gunners, fall back. Weapon teams, make ready. He bellowed. And the heavy bolter teams took up their equipment and fell back. Now the gatehouse of the city was a fortress in and of itself. It stood nearly 100 meters tall, with the gates being 60 meters, so that even an Imperator Titan might stride out of them. Above this gate stood the house proper, and it was 40 meters tall, and spanned 80 meters between two great towers, covering the full width of the great bridge and even more. And these towers each stretched 10 meters above the top of the walls. And the length of the wall was 30 meters. Constantine had left the first third of this bare, so as to create a killing field, and behind that was a series of cleverly constructed diagonal walls, such that any advancing foe would have no benefit from them, but the defenders would always be shielded. Now the enemy summited the wall, and was immediately consumed in a deluge of fire. Upon the wall there were many guardsmen, and from the two towers fire rained. Such was the onslaught that there was barely space for a fly to pass through without being struck by a LAS shot or bolter shell. Yet while the fire was without number, so too were the tyrannids. Many shots simply missed, and of those that hit, barely half struck anywhere that mattered. The swarm moved into the killing ground, and a wave of gaunts approached. At the same time, the gargoyles entered range, and the whole of the city was beset by them. They attacked everywhere at once, hoping to find any point of weakness they might exploit. For as they cracked the city open, Their seemingly infinite numbers would surely triumph. Yet the Iron Hand did not leave such things as weak points. From the top of every roof, from every spire and every place, there erupted a great storm of flak. The city's main gun swept away entire squadrons with their overwhelming anti-starship weaponry. The maelstrom of Tyranids blotted out the sun, but the combined muzzle flashes of an entire city worth of defenses gave the daylight regardless. That day, it rained blood and gore, and the slaughter was unlike anything seen upon that world, and greater than it would ever see again. Upon the wall, the great darkness and slaughter sank into the hearts of the men. The endless hordes pushed through, and their ammunition began to dry. Then the Termagaunts summited the wall, and began to fire back, followed swiftly by six great Carnifexes. Behind them buzzed Hive Tyrants on malefic wings. Their combined psionic might was thrown against the resolve of the guard, and they began to despair. Seeing this, the kill team knew that the time had come. Andriel threw back his hood, releasing the dampeners upon his abilities. He opened his mind, and drank in the raw emotion of the battle. He bore it within himself, and raised up his staff. Warp lightning flashed in the darkness, tearing out of nowhere to strike it. Illuminated in the eldritch light, his golden hair flew back in the wind, like a hero of ages long past. With great effort, he pushed his unfettered psychic might against the Tyranids. He opened his mouth, and roared like a lion of ancient terror, the sound reverberating across both physical and spiritual planes. For the guard, it granted them great courage, and to the Tyranid, it rattled them, the base instincts of the lesser Xenos responding to the sound of a greater predator. Show them the light of the Emperor. Let it burn their accursed hides. HCSVNT Dracones. Aishvan roared, and strode forwards into the horde. His mighty flame roared to life, and granted light into the gatehouse. About him the flamer teams rallied, and they swept the lesser Tyranids away beneath an ocean of flame. The Carnifexes charged forwards, seeking to overwhelm the flamer teams, but already forces moved against them. On the left, Morn unleashed precise and deadly bolt of fire into their eyes, and blinded them. He then concentrated all fire on one's left leg, sundering it and causing the creature to fall under its own weight. Aitra rallied a unit armed with Meltus, and they countercharged the rampaging beast, blue plasma leading the way. It tore towards them, guided by the eyes of the hive mind. Hold! Aitra ordered, waiting until the monster was just near enough to be within maximum effect. Fire! She ordered, and the Meltigans opened up. The front half of the Carnifex vanished under a wave of superheated air. Its momentum, however, did not. The massive corpse threatened to crush them, until Morn intervened. Moving with almost supernatural speed, he checked the corpse, diverting it away from the guardsmen. In the center, Aishvan began to fall back. Even his masterfully crafted weapon would not be sufficient to stop the living battering rams headed for him. Fortunately, Wathin was charging in from an angle. The old wolf took his axe in both hands, and met the Carnifex almost head-on. But not quite head-on. As the great beast lashed its head to gore him, the space marine altered his course slightly, and swung with all his might into the side of the monster's head. With a great wrench, he bent the Carnifex's head down into the side, so that the beast's own charge carried it forwards and broke its neck. It crashed into the side of the other Carnifex, slowing it slightly. Wathin made for the beast's back leg, and Aishvan covered him. The cleansing flame swept over the screening swarm and burned them to ash, but had no effect upon the ceramite armor of the space wolf. Wathin's axe bit into the Carnifex's leg like a great tree. If not for the flickering force field, the weapon surely would have been caught up and torn from his grasp, but instead it clove through and severed it neatly. The beast turned to rake the wolf with its tusks, but Wathin was faster, and had the momentum. He counterclove with the axe, severing both tusks in twain and shredding the teeth of the creature's mouth. With that, he raised his axe high and delivered a devastating blow to the Xeno's forehead. It struck right between the eyes, but was not enough to reach the brain. The beast slammed him, sending him screeching back and wheezing for breath. But he drew his bolt pistol from his hip, and fired thrice into the wound he had cloven. The bolt shells pierced through, and reduced the beast's brain to paste. The last two came against where Andriel stood, and he threw his arcane might against them. Unable to strike their minds with the tyrant Sonya, he was forced to contend against their flesh instead. He formed a thin plane of telekinetic force, and thrust it under the feet of the charging Xenos. With tremendous effort, he pushed up and toppled them, though they began to rise anew. Before he could finish them, he fell to his knees as the tyrants turned their full focus upon him. The raw weight of the hive mind slammed him into the ground, so that the permacrete cracked. His eyes began to weep blood, and reality flickered around him as he drew on dangerous amounts of warp power to resist. His staff flickered, the focusing crystal pushing itself to its limits. Somewhat ironically, the one who would prevent his death was the one who hated him most. Constantine, having evaluated the situation, had already taken to the air on his jump pack to repel the gargoyles, flew to a position above the hovering tyrants. Then he offered a prayer of hatred, deactivated his jump pack, and fell like a guillotine. With their focus on destroying the troublesome Sicker, the Cabal did not recognize his presence until it was too late. Constantine hurled a crack grenade at one, stunning it and setting it ablaze, then struck down the one in the center. Both hands on his blade, he put all his strength, momentum, and weight into a single blow. With a mighty strike, he clove the wings from the tyrant's back, and sent it plummeting to its death. The one he set ablaze recovered, and turned its weaponry towards him. However, the flame did more than burn the creature, it highlighted it. With a series of cracks, a half dozen Lascanans, brought up to deal with the Carnifexes, shot it out of the air. The remaining tyrant trained its weapons on Constantine. The Templar reactivated his jump pack, slowing his descent and beginning to propel him back towards the wall. For a moment though, he was almost still, an easy shot. The tyrant began to fire, when its weapon limbs broke to the side with a crack. Andriel rose, power flickering about him. With a wordless cry of hate, he unleashed his fury in a massive bolt of psychic lightning, which struck the tyrant in the side. At the same moment, Constantine soared into reach, and drove his sword to the hilt into its chest. He tore upwards, splitting the alien's skull in twain. With the death of their leader, this wave faltered for a moment, and Andriel took his chance. He struck a thousand tiny needles into the primitive, reeling minds of the attacking creatures, stunning them. Then, with a great effort, he lifted up the Carnifexes and cast them back over the wall, along with many lesser creatures. He fell to a knee, coughing up blood and an iridescent glowing substance, his veins gleaming from overuse of his powers. With effort, he drew his hood back over his head, dampening his powers once more. He weakly recited dogmas, breathing deeply until the glow faded, and the pain ceased. "Don't push yourself too early. There's a lot more," Wathin advised, and the sound of scrambling proved him right. "Begin the retreat while we have half a moment. We are running low on ammunition at this position," Morn ordered. And the second wave struck. Chapter 8, Cowardice and Valiance. It took no more than a minute for the Xenos to remount their assault. No longer hampered by the powerful wall guns, they came swiftly over the side. The first wave had devoured the defenders' ammunition, even with runners constantly moving to bring up more. The bastion towers were becoming inundated with gargoyles and other fouler creatures. This position had served its purpose well, and thousands of tyrannids now lay dead before the gate, but it was time to pull back. They had defense upon defense to fall back on, so long as they had the men to man them. It was a testament to the iron will of Morn and Constantine that the retreat remained disciplined. They did not break and run, but made a fighting withdrawal, pouring fire into the foe until their weapons ran dry. Many fell back across the walls, until they approached a narrow bridge. Others retreated into the fortress within a fortress that was the gatehouse. Morn oversaw the retreat to the bridge, sweeping the area and coming to an odd conclusion. "Aetra, where are the platoon and company commanders?" he asked. The sergeant ducked behind cover and vented her plasma gun. "If my history with them has taught me anything, farther back than the artillery, protecting their well-appointed asses, pardon my language." Morn paused for half a moment, as sheer, mind-numbing rage briefly overcame his otherwise programmed calm. "Acknowledged. You are hereby granted command over all forces in this sector until the officer corps are issued augmented spines and returned to the field. Oversee the retreat and defense of the bridge. I am broadcasting your updated rank to your fellow officers. Serve well. By your will, Lord Morn. Aitra replied, a savage grin taking over her face. By the Emperor, there were such things as miracles. Now all she had to do was survive, both the tyrannids and the angry nobles. She rose, and drew her chains ward as the enemy closed. She focused her grip, adjusted her stance, and turned aside the rush. The teeth of the weapon bit into the Xeno, and dragged it deeper on, rending its way through. With a ripping swing, she cast the Hormagaunt back, and then clove another away, sending it flying off the wall in two halves. For the Emperor. Jacobs, double time, they won't slow down. Koroth, stand and rank fire, cover the left. We can't let the Astartes do all the work. She took to that well. Ishvan observed to Constantine as the pair held down the right. The salamander remained in good humor despite the circumstances. Talk less, kill more. Constantine replied curtly, whirling through a swarm of Gaunts contemptuously. You judged her better than I. He admitted. The battle came to the briefest lull as a heavy bolt pushed the swarm back. Watch the depths well, cousin. And may all their champions fall to your blades, brother. Ishvan saluted, and the two split. Ishvan and Warthin headed into the fortress to oversee the retreat back down the wall, and to ensure the enemy could not open the great gate. Constantine fell back beneath a hail of fire, the last to retreat to the single bridge that connected the upper gatehouse towards the inner sections. Once he was clear of the last section of his defenses, he sent a signal through his vox. It appeared to be nothing more than random numbers, but it made sense to what it needed to. Namely, the charges he had built into his defenses, which erupted in a massive fireball, consuming the Xenos and denying them any cover. Would that I had more Promethium. Alas, there is never enough. He muttered. The flames and overwatch fire brought a moment of calm to evaluate their new situation. They had fallen back to yet another raised position, hardened with heavy weapons emplacements and his own architectural modifications. Two great star towers rose on either side of the bridge, pouring fire down on their former positions. If he had ammunition enough, perhaps they might have held forever. But there might be more tyrannids than bolt shells. Around him, the mortals took the moments to drink from canteens and bite into nutrient bars. Aitra walked the fortifications, speaking with the troops, gathering what she could. Your grip was good. You overextended on the counter slash. He informed her. Do not do the same with your men. The sudden high of recognition was replaced with a bone-quaking fear. Do you not approve, my lord? She asked, keeping most of it from her voice. If I did, I would take it up with Morn. You are diligent, loyal, and determined to learn and please. He replied. You are a fine guardsman. Am I fine enough for this? She asked. I do not know. I am a swordsman with no desire or talent for leadership. The Emperor made me a weapon, and so I fulfill my purpose. I do not think beyond it. Do the same. Do your duty, and think not for what comes next. Constantine bid her. The flames of his trap began to die, and the tyrannid returned. For what comes next are Xenos, and we shall not be done purging them for some time. As if to confirm his statement, the next great swarm massed and pushed through the dying embers. At the same time, gargoyles swept down out the sky in great numbers and density, such that the AA could not clear them. Constantine stepped forth onto the bridge, waiting to halt the swarm. He raised his blade to a vertical position, and focused. The Auspex array in his helmet went into overdrive, and he took measured, meditative breaths. His mind focused, then expanded, concentrating on taking all the data his superhuman senses could. It would have pushed any mortal man to catatonia, as the world almost seemed to slow. He understood intimately each tyrannid before him, eidetic memory drawing forth the Death Watch's encyclopedic knowledge of all Xenos. He understood the Horde as the Horde understood itself. It was not many creatures, but a single abominable mind with untold limbs. To predict the movements of so many individuals would be impossible, even for an Astartes. But this was a single individual, a duel against a monster that would devour the entire galaxy with a trillion maws. But for all its Lovecraftian immensity, it was still only one mind to match against, and on this ground, Constantine was its match. He moved against the Horde, psychic lightning from Andriel and precise bolt of fire from Morn covering him, while the guard's defenses formed a box of fire to hold the majority of the swarm. He closed with the coming beasts, taking in everything. Slight shifts in their position, the whisper of breath flowing into their lungs, the scent of adrenal pheromones and the quickening of the blood revealed their plans to him. Their possible attacks shifted, first from 100 different patterns, to a dozen, and then their last movements collapsed the web into a certain future. And he would shatter that future. His power sword moved in sharp, exact motions, almost like a conductor's baton, albeit with more mechanical precision. He cut off a dozen lives in a moment, stopping each attack on his left side. On his right, the long knife in his offhand met the talons of the enemy, his superhuman strength breaking by weapons with mere parries. With a single slash, he tore the mana molecular edge across four throats. He moved almost gracefully, each step calculated to place him in an optimal position for his next movement. Two more steps, four dozen more claws turned away by whirling blades and power armor. He registered the roars of Morn's bolters, caught after images of the paths the shells tore in the air to clear his path. One more step, a single thrust. His blade pierced through a Tyranid and struck the one behind. The tip just piercing its skull and entering the frontal lobe of its brain. He tore it free and stepped forwards, finishing the newly lobotomized prime. His attack on the synapse creature had staggered the section of the Horde, and its death broke it. The Xenos faltered for a moment, giving the Marines the precious seconds they needed to eliminate this sector of the Horde, before the next tendril of the swarm came against him. Six times the enemy came against the Black Swordsman. Six times he cast down their champions, and threw their broken bodies from the bridge. Great beasts they sent against him, but the guns of the towers cast them down, and the hellfire rounds from Morn broke them. Zoanthropes, lesser psionic Xenos, threw the will of the hive mind against him, but his faith and contempt shielded him long enough for Andriel to destroy them. Supported by his fellow astartes, he held against the tide, though his armor endured such abuse that it was almost more silver than black. Fully half the foe were obliterated by the guard and their mighty ordnance, and of those that survived, half again penetrated the gate, seeking to throw it open wide so the full might of the swarm might enter the city. Andriel and Morn destroyed half of what remained, such that Constantine faced only an eighth of each wave. Even so, an eighth still numbered in the dozens. Those who sought to throw open the gate found themselves funneled into an even crueler series of choker points. In the narrow corridors, the Tyranid could not bring their overwhelming advantage in numbers or their mightiest bioforms to bear. Furthermore, they no longer were guaranteed superiority over the guardsmen, as the Ogryn auxiliaries guarded the heavy weapons teams. By their terrific strength and savagery, the Tyranids were outmatched in melee for a time. Though their immeasurable numbers brought with them immeasurable pressure, steadily forcing the Imperials back. Black Xeno blood flowed freely through the halls, mixing with the far more valuable human red. Yet wherever the enemy seemed ready to break through, Wathin and Aishvan appeared. Few could withstand the flame of the Salamander, and none the fury of the Son of Fenris. Together they held the defense together. In a moment of pause, Wathin took note of the blood, though he could not be certain of why. The red and black flowed together, intermingling until one could not be withdrawn from the other. It sent a chill down the old wolf's spine, though he could not understand why. He was no seer, but this was an ill omen. He was certain of it. The runes on his axe gleamed coldly in the dark corridor, though whether it was merely the effect of the force field or something deeper he had never been able to tell, and certainly had no time to figure out. At this point the battle had raged with only the briefest of pauses for 2 hours, and while the gate held, it was swiftly becoming one of the last areas on the outermost walls. Nearly all had fallen back to the second line of defenses, as Morn had called for, and many had even retreated to the third line. There were in total almost 40 lines, but a loss of territory was still a loss of territory. They had bled the enemy fiercely, but the Horde still stretched beyond the horizon. But the gatehouse continued to hold, and the surrounding sectors had not retreated any further, even as the enemy began to pressure their flanks. This sector of the wall could not be allowed to fall until there was no other option but to retreat, and even then, the gates had to be destroyed before even that option was allowed. So, hold they did, and hold well, in spite of the heaviest onslaught. The Astarte certainly deserved much of the credit for this feat, but the guard performed more admirably than they had in all the regiment's career. They fought for their home, and for once, they fought with an active commander. The officers of the Alvarin regiments were standard, that is to say they were hive nobles there for politics rather than competence. Naturally, they spent most of their time sitting in the rear, taking credit for victories, and executing any who did not adhere to the chain of command. It was not that the men of Alvara were any less noble, courageous, or disciplined than any other regiment, merely that they were cursed with a patrician's command structure. But the elevation of one of the remarkably capable sergeants remedied this otherwise fatal flaw. An outside commander might have earned the troops grudging gratitude simply for being there, but one of their own? That person could be trusted. And Aitra did all she could to earn that trust. She moved like a dynamo, rushing here and there across the walls to ensure the ammo kept flowing, and the men kept firing. All the while, she continued to pour fire down upon the enemy whenever she was able to stand still. Yet in spite of all of their efforts, the tyrannid could not be denied forever. The fatal blow came from the skies, when a cloud of gargoyles descended upon one of the defense towers. A hive tyrant led the assault, blasting a hole in the side of the tower with a bioacid cannon. As it fell upon the defenders, it unleashed a horrific psionic scream, which broke the men and sent them running. The gargoyles swarmed into the tower, beginning to overwhelm any brave enough to remain. Morn watched this development bitterly. He prepared to send the order to destroy the gates and pull back, when he looked towards heaven. The skies were ablaze as the Imperial Navy forced its way towards the planet, closer than they had ever been. The battle was clearly fierce, the Navy taking a fight on the Tyranid's own terms. But they would only do that if. Morn quickly checked the patterns of the clouds, and saw that they were beginning to be parted. They pulled away, as a particularly bright star grew brighter. Beneath his helmet, Morn grinned. The god machines were coming. If the gate could hold, they could win this war yet. He turned from his reverie and redoubled his fire. Without the support of the left tower, the Xenos came upon the bridge in greater numbers. He stepped forwards, Mercadentride swirling as he came to Constantine's aid. Aitra. The tower must be retaken. Victory is coming, but the gate must hold. He ordered her. Do whatever it takes. Aitra prepared to reply in the affirmative, but froze. She knew what was in that tower. It would rebred ruin among her men, and the Astartes would not be there to support. Even without the cyclic attack, dread gripped her heart. Her mouth went dry, her vision swam. He was ordering her to lead her comrades to their deaths. Aitra, do you hear me? The tower must be taken. The gate must hold. Victory is coming. He ordered again. She tried to force herself to respond, to move. Time was growing shorter. She could hear the enemy coming down through the tower. It would be upon them all soon. They were all going to die. Fear is a fundamental instinct, part of what makes us human. It is our biological programming that tells us that a thing that threatens our survival is present. It is perhaps the rawest form of the great human ability to survive and thrive, no matter the circumstances. So do not be ashamed that you fear. You would have to be insane to not ever feel it, especially with the great devourer at our gates. Use it. Let it sharpen all your senses, and awaken the same tenacity and drive which is within all humans, whether they are blessed with gene enhancements or not. Wathin's words reminded her, the wisdom of the old wolf breaking through the terror. The fear melted, and something colder took its place. Her face and heart hardened, adrenaline and ice roaring through her bloodstream. It shall be done, my lord. She answered, and she gathered her men. Her own squad. 3 units of veterans, 2 units of flamers, 2 rocket launcher teams and a melter squad. They assembled and prepared to breach the fallen tower. As they did so, the door flew open, and half a squad ran screaming out. Aitra hardened her heart, and did her duty. Stepping forwards, She slammed her chainsword into the first deserter's face and revved the engine. His head was sucked onto the blade and utterly destroyed. The rest of the fleeing men stopped. "If that tower falls, we all die. Now do your duty." Atra snarled, doing her best impression of a commissar. It worked, and the men halted, more afraid of her than the Xenos. Behind them the gargoyles began to emerge from the tower. Atra ordered her flamer squads forwards, and they suppressed the entrance. "Fix bayonets," Atra ordered, and the men did so. Once they were done, she lowered her chainsword, and the flames ceased. "For the Emperor," she roared, and they charged, shotguns roaring. The sudden ferocity of the assault caught the Tyranids by surprise, and they cast them back from the lowest level. Atra led the way, blasting the head from one, and cutting down another with a slash of her blade. Around her, the veterans tore into the enemy, giving space for the special weapons teams. The flamers lit the dim rooms with burning corpses, and the swoop of Meltigans eliminated the tightest pockets. They maintained their momentum, forcing their way up the stairs. Men fell to the claws and bile of the gargoyles, but they pushed on. Reinforcements poured in from both sides, and the tower was filled with slaughter. But the ferocity of the veterans and the prospect of victory was enough, as they cut their way to the fourth floor. Through the tight corridors they relentlessly advanced, sweeping aside the foe with discipline and wrath. On Atra's flank, a unit rounded a corner, ready to let fly with their shotguns. Instead, they exploded, their skulls and spines torn from their bodies by an invisible force. Then it came around the corner. The Hive Tyrant, a massive, heavily armored creature that filled the whole corridor, and had to stoop to avoid dragging its head through the ceiling. Swifter than any creature of that size should be, it impaled two more members of the squad on a bone sword, then swept it aside to bisect two more. Atra's mind went white, then red. "Fall back. Don't let it get close," she ordered the remainder of her men, pulling back and opening fire with her plasma gun. It struck the monster as it charged, letting forth another psychic howl. The retreat nearly turned into a rout, the stairs becoming cluttered. The behemoth leveled its acid cannon, and Atra realized its ploy. "Get down," she ordered, tackling one of her men down the stairs. A blast of bioacid melted several guardsmen, and splashed onto her arm. She rolled away, tearing off that section of carapace armor before the acid could eat through into her. The tyrant came down the stairs, ripping into the men with blade and psychic blast. The veterans held, firing shotguns into the beast and trying to pierce its hide. Black blood flowed from dozens of wounds, but none enough to even slow the monster down. It tore through them as easily as Constantine did Gaunt's, casting their scattered bodies about like toys. Atra screamed in defiance, beyond the point of fear or conscious thought. She flicked the plasma gun to high-powered mode, and fired. The massive blast of blue-hot plasma finally staggered the monster, melting one of its wings to the wall. It tore free, gathering its focus and advancing on the lone sergeant. She braced for death, charging another shot, when the swoop of the Meltigan squad saved her. The tyrant reeled forwards, then whirled. A blast of rage and pain struck the team, boiling their flesh off of their bones and reducing them to a soupy mess. Atra fired, but the sight made her retch, and the shot went wide. She vomited onto the floor, thinking that this was a particularly humiliating position to die in before an explosion rocked her world. When she came to her senses, she saw a very large hole in the wall where the tyrant used to be. A rocket team had fired, and their blast had detonated the charge packs on the Melter squad's corpses, taking most of the tyrant and a sizable chunk of the wall with it. Atra got up with some assistance and oversaw cleanup of the Tyranids, not her vomit. As new men manned the guns, she had a moment, and the reality of what had just happened struck her. The memory of the Melter team's deaths burned into her mind, and she was grateful there was nothing of their corpses remaining. Her limbs shook slightly. Now she understood why she feared and despised the witch. She opened her vox to inform Morn of their success, when a great sound shook the tower. A brilliant light filled the outside, and then the whole planet seemed to shake. She hailed Morn. "Lord Morn, do you copy? What manner of new devilry is this?" not devilry, salvation. Morn reported. Titan Nimrod has come. No tabletop RPG is complete without beautiful models on the table, and the best place to get models is from us. If you check the link below, we have everything you could need for your magical realm. Only the finest of big titty wafers here. But if you're not into models or don't play with models, we got you covered with subclasses such as the Gachimashi Wizards, the Simp Warlock, and the North FC Fighter. Also, we have started selling 5th edition adventures, with our first one featuring Belle Delphine, the succubus that has poisoned the town's well and turned the villagers into simps. If any of that stuff sounds fun to you, go ahead and check the link below, but let's get back to the video. Chapter 9, A Titanic Climax. Constantine had fought alongside the god machines of the Mechanicum before, within the crusade to retake the lost forge world of Ozma, but he had never seen one land. What came first was a noise, and not merely a noise, but an all-consuming, all-encompassing noise. It drowned out the sound of battle with a low rumble, which built and built. Then there was the light. The coming of Titan's massive carrier craft disrupted the weather, and blew all the clouds to the horizon. The gargoyles and all others that dwelt in the air were blown away by the winds. And the lander descended, gleaming white hot from the re-entry, like a crashing star or burning mountain. When it landed, all the earth shook, and even the Tyranids and Astartes were staggered. The sheer enormity of what had just descended boggled the mind, and stunned even the alien. And then, silence. The battle held almost awkwardly. The Tyranids in this sector at least slunk back a few steps, cautious of this new entry. Constantine watched them, but did not over-pursue. In sectors far enough from the drop point, the attack resumed swiftly, but around it, every eye, alien or human, was focused on the lander. What had fallen from the sky was nothing short of a building, and a very large building at that. It had landed upon the main causeway before the gate, and filled it utterly. Its descent had torn off sections of nearby buildings, and crushed them beneath its bulk. It resembled a mighty, albeit slightly boxy, cathedral, all solid pillars and integrated supports, so that it might resist the great stresses. It stood just over 30 meters tall, and was very long, far longer, one would think, than for a titan. The Tyranids began to regather themselves, to launch another, concentrated assault, when another great sound gave them pause. The mighty doors of the Skyborn Cathedral began to open, and war horns sounded, such that all the city was filled with their clarion call. At this, the whole city gave out a mighty cry. The guardsmen punched their fists and rifles into the air if they were able, offering prayers of thanksgiving. The bells of the Manufactorum tolled joyously, and all the Mechanicus raised up a beautiful and happy binary chant. Even the kill team could not hide their satisfaction at this sight. Constantine gave a great shout, proclaiming the glory of the Emperor. Morn lowered his head in awe. Andriel felt the miasma of despair lift from the city, as a cloud passes away before the wind. Within the gatehouse, Ashvan took pause, not recognizing the sound at first, but Wathin simply grinned. "Now things get entertaining," he said with a laugh. With earth-shaking thuds, the Titan strode forth. 23 meters tall, the god machine stood, covered in the indigo and red of its legion markings. Upon both arms bristled incredible weaponry, the rival of starships. Upon its back were mounted two more bastions of apocalyptic firepower. Morn watched it move with something like religious awe. It was a bellicose Mars Beta type Reaver Battle Titan, among the mightiest of the Omnigia's weaponry. On its right arm was mounted a plasma destructor, and at its left a mighty Gatling blaster, which began to whirring at life. "Fall back. Get clear," Morn ordered, and the men retreated. The Tyranids pursued, but not swiftly enough. A wave of heat, light, fire, and sound swept over the gatehouse battlements. So many shells, and of such size, that where one ended and another began could not be determined. In but an instant, it was scoured of all life. Aethra poked her head out from behind cover, and beheld a riven and smoking wasteland, layers of plating peeled back like the wrapping on a nutrient bar. "Fethmi with a spanner," she cursed under her breath. She had heard stories of the god machine's power, but witnessing it herself was something else entirely. The Titan spoke, its voice booming out across the city. "Open the gate." About its feet, an army emerged from the lander. Dozens of tanks, scores of Skitterii, and many other Mechanicus vehicles that he did not recognize, loping, crawling, and otherwise advancing forth. At the gate controls, the mortals hesitated for a moment, until Wathin laid a hand on their shoulders. Both of them at once. With one hand. "Lads, when a titan tells you to do something, you do it. He's about to win this war." The great gates began to swing open, and the tyrannid surged forwards, pushed even tighter together in their rush. The princeps had clearly expected this, as he leveled the plasma destructor. A blinding light erupted from it, obliterating everything. Thousands of Xenos, wiped out in an instant. The weapon swung upwards, and carved a canyon of ruined flesh and scorched permacrete across the bridge. As the doors opened fully, all the Titan's guns unleashed into the tightly packed tyrannids, as it marched inexorably forwards. About its feet, its auxiliaries unleashed their own weaponry, exterminating anything so fortunate as to survive the god machine's gaze. "Cast them down. For the Emperor." Constantine roared to the guard, and charged. For the first time, the men of Alvara took the offensive to clear the remaining Xenos from the walls. Any attempts by the Xenos to summit the walls were rendered nearly impossible by the firepower of the victorious Titan, cutting the endless Xenos reinforcements to a minimum. The guard, possessed by an almost divine fervor, fired until their lasguns grew hot in their hands. Aitra took what remained of her command squad, and they charged across the bridge to support Constantine. Flamer, Melter, Boot and Bayonet cast down the Xenos. In the center, Constantine clove a bloody path through the Tyrannid, Aitra following behind. Her chainsword roared, and she laid waste to the foe, firing her plasma whenever she could not reach an enemy within a few steps. Morn continued to deliver precise fire support from the wall, joining his voice to the binary praises of the Mechanicum. Soon, a gout of flame and the bark of a bolt pistol heralded the return of Aishvan and Wathin, at the head of a massive Ogryn charge. Constantine's focus slipped momentarily at the sight of the wretched Abhumans, but his hate for the alien was stronger. He resisted the urge to vomit, as together, the Astartes, Guard, and Ogryns cast the Tyrannids down from the walls and reclaimed the upper gatehouse. The Titan continued forth his inexorable march, plasma and massive shells annihilating the enemy in their tens of thousands. "Lord Morn, if I may ask, what are our odds now?" Aitra asked with a grin. The Dirtech Marine smiled under his helmet. "I would say that they are very good," he replied. "Oddly imprecise. Truly you are in a good humor," Aishvan commented. "And why not? This is a great victory." "Oh, by the spirits, he said it," Wathin cursed. "Boy, have you never learned to not ever say that? It tempts the fates, and the fates are cruel mistresses. Cousin Wathin, I have a great deal of respect for you as a warrior, but your superstitions are unbecoming," Constantine replied. "Mark my words. This isn't over. I've a grim feeling for all of this," Wathin replied, scanning the area. "Look, the Xenos are acting too clever by half. They're retreating." Indeed, as they looked down from the great gate, they saw something as strange as a waterfall flowing upwards. The great Tyrannid swarm occupying the bridge was falling back, pulling away from the gate and the great death that marched through it. Any normal army would have rooted by now, and been caught against itself, but the swarm rolled back as one. It was an eerily smooth and controlled movement, setting all of them at edge. "They're up to something," Wathin said with a growl, watching the seasoned skies, which still boiled with Xenos. Shadows passed in the Red Seas, too deep for even the enhanced eyes of the Astartes to make out. The Titan continued to march forwards, pursuing the enemy relentlessly. The ancient and bellicose machine spirit combined with the youthful aggression of its princeps, sounding its horn for yet more death. It passed beyond the gates, and Wathin's eyes narrowed. "Look. They're in the deeps. It's a trap." Morn immediately activated his Vorx, but realized to his horror he could not reach the Titan. It had only a few minutes ago entered the field, and been too preoccupied to establish a link with him directly. He hailed Central Command, ordering them to patch him through to the Titan. Too little, too late. The trap was already sprung. The shadows of the seas darkened and hardened until they erupted in a spray of foam. Aitra looked down and turned pale, backing away from the edge of the wall and falling on the battle-scarred ground. "Emperor, preserve us," she whispered. For from the sea had come the largest tyrannid she had ever seen, larger than any that could have filled her nightmares. Her heart pounded, her blood roared, the biological mechanisms of her body malfunctioning in response to something it was never meant to see or comprehend. They were like great crabs, covered in spines and chitin, standing upon four armored legs. They were easily 10 meters tall, and just as wide. They must have weighed several thousand tons, yet they moved swifter than tanks. Aishvan seized her in one hand, and the Astartes sprinted for cover. 4. Morn cursed. Rust and rot. 4. One had emerged before the Titan and rushed at it head on. From a thousand pores it unleashed an ocean of bioacid and a forest of tree-sized spines, but the attack fizzled harmlessly against the void shields. The god machine sounded its challenge, and supercharged its plasma destructor. At this range, it was impossible to miss, and the blast tore the Bio-Titan in half. It bore time for its comrades though, for even the mightiest tyrannid is but an expendable tool to the hive mind. The second rushed the Titan from the side, firing wildly. Its ammunition was no more effective than the first, until it rushed within the shield. The shield was far from the last defense of the god machine though, and its side became engulfed with sparks as the armor deflected the worst of the damage. It swung its Gatling cannon to engage, but the tyrannid leapt atop it, rending with its claws. The massive scything talons and rending claws carved gashes into the armor, but this was not the true threat. Instead, the sheer weight and momentum of the massive beast caused the Titan to stagger, backing towards the edge of the bridge. The third Hierophant raced over the top of the gatehouse, summiting it with horrific speed. The Astartes ran, fleeing deeper into the fortress. Aishvan covered Aitra with his body, and smothered her mouth and nose with a hand. The lack of breath compounded the sergeant's terror, and she kicked and flailed fruitlessly against the armored warrior. As the shadow of the beast passed over, it unleashed a chemical attack. Toxic vapors and infectious spores inundated the fortress, melting and poisoning anything they touched. As they melted through discarded power packs, they ignited the gases, and a fireball swept over the battlements. The fire calcified the spores, and they shot forth like shrapnel, piercing into anything and everything. Aishvan staggered from the blast. His armor preserved him from the worst of the spores, but such were their number that many found their way through. He bled for only an instant, blood practically freezing as soon as it began to bleed. Even so, he dropped Aitra, and his vision began to swim. The toxic spines would have brought instant death to any mortal, and while Aishvan was far hardier, the sheer amount of them began to battle against his enhanced physiology. Morn saw this, and raced to his battle brother's side. He tore the gauntlet from his right hand, exposing the mechanical limb beneath. With a whir, a panel opened up, exposing an uncomfortably large syringe. He tore Aishvan's helm from his head, and stabbed the needle into his throat. The larger starts his breathing began to grow stronger, his vision cleared. The powerful antivenom provided all his system needed to quickly and completely expel the poisons, followed by the spines, from his body. Was that Constantine began to ask, but Swathin cut him off. "Deal with it later. We have Titans to deal with. Morn, Aishvan, Aitra," he began, then paused. He knelt by the nearly catatonic goods woman, and clapped his hands in front of her face. The sudden sound caused her to blink and gasp for breath. "Go to the controls. Shut the gate. Make ready for another attack. Prepare to destroy it after you shut it. Andriel, coordinate our forces. Break mines if you need to. Get all our heavier support up the main causeway and have it engage from maximum range. Constantine, with me," he ordered, then started running. Constantine followed him and the other Astartes made for the control room. Aitra staggered to her feet, shook her head, and followed after them. Duty came first. Then the mental breakdown, and a whole lot of Amzek. As the Wolf and the Templar raced back to the battlements, the third Hierophant executed its attack. Scurrying under the arch of the gate to avoid the Titan's weapons, it launched itself at the reeling god machine. The impact sent it back further, nearly toppling it into the sea. However, the machine would not fall so easily, and it swung its Gatling cannon free. It shredded the second Hierophant, and turned its plasma to obliterate the third. Then the fourth Titan emerged from the seas, and it was unlike the others. It seemed cephalic, like a Finrisian kraken, with many armored tentacles. It wrapped its tentacles about the Titan's arm and throat, and braced itself against the bridge. With tremendous effort, it hauled the off-balance god machine down. The plasma destructor fired wildly, melting one of the defense towers to slag. The third Hierophant leapt clear with a scree of triumph, as god machine and kraken vanished beneath the waves in a titanic splash. After allowing itself the merest instance of triumph, the Bio-Titan set to work annihilating the Imperial spearhead. It rent, tore, burnt, and poisoned with animalistic glee, trampling and overturning tanks, sweeping away Skitterii formations with waves of pyroacid, and melting circuitry, steel, and flesh all together into an unrecognizable morass. With the spearhead effectively broken, the Titan rushed for the gate. Behind it, the Tyranid swarm had turned, and now moved with the same eerie smoothness and speed back to the open city. The Hierophant threw all its fury against the gates, for if they were to be sundered, the city would surely fall. Wathin, I fail to see how the two of us are going to kill a Titan. Constantine admitted. I am fully confident in my Bladywalk, but I do not have a big enough sword for this, and I do not think your axe will quite do the job either. That is because you lack both imagination and a melter bomb. The elder Astartes replied. With that, he took a few steps back, ran towards the edge of the battlements, and leapt. Constantine paused, blinked, and blinked again. He is insane. The Black Templar concluded, and leapt after the mad wolf. The two Astartes plummeted towards the Titan, and landed on its back with a crash of splintering chitin and exploding flesh. Their armor and incredible anatomy protected them from any real damage, but the fall was certainly not comfortable. They struggled to keep their footing as the Titan moved, but they managed. About them, things like boils began to burst, revealing yet more Tyranids. So, it has an immune system. Something to add to the files when we return. Wathin noted as he drew his weapons. To the head. With that, he opened fire, and began to charge down the monster's back. Constantine followed, twin blades dancing and keeping the immune system off of them. They fought like madmen as the boils burst, and the back of the Titan became covered in toxic fumes. Constantine's helmet preserved him, but Wathin was still not wearing his. This is why we wear them. The Templar complained vocally as he cut a pair of bioforms in half. The old wolf held his breath, and did not reply. Blasting and hacking his way forwards, he came to the base of the monster's skull. Taking his axe in both hands, he cut a great gash, exposing the spine. However, this wound to such a vulnerable area alerted the creature to his presence. It bucked and thrashed, trying to throw the Astartes off. It succeeded, hurling Constantine from its back. The Templar fired his jump pack, soaring back, only to nearly be thrown again. Wathin, on the other hand, was thrown into the air. Twisting, he bit his axe into one of the spines atop its crown, and swung himself back. He landed, feet first, inside one of the monster's many eyes, plunging up to his waist. Undeterred, he drew his bolt pistol and emptied the clip, obliterating the eye and giving him some space. Bracing himself inside the eye, he hacked away at the back of the socket, until he exposed the optic nerve. Returning his axe to his belt, he took the ropey nerve in both hands and hauled, tearing it out by the root. The Titan screamed, shaking its head violently. Wathin could feel himself being shaken out, so he took the melter bomb, armed it, and threw it down the passage the optic nerve once occupied. An instant later, he was flung violently from the eye. "Lad, I would appreciate some assistance." He calmly voxed Constantine as he tumbled through the air. Constantine leapt from the monster's back, just as the bomb detonated. An explosion tore through the creature's brain, killing it instantly. As the fiend collapsed, Constantine pushed his jump pack to the limit, catching the falling wolf and trying to pull free from the dive. However, he had asked too much of the machine, and it overheated, screamed, and exploded. The tour starts fell in a parabolic arc towards a building. Wathin attempted to curse, but had little time before they smashed through the wall and two floors before rolling to a stop. They lay there, flat on their backs, for a long moment. Then they remained for another long moment, processing what madness had just occurred. "We are still alive," Constantine noted. "Yes. I suppose it would hurt less if we were not," Wathin replied. "Then our duty has not ended," the Templar replied, and struggled to his feet. Wathin attempted to rise, somewhat slowly, and the younger offered him a hand up. "I really am getting old," Wathin grumbled, cracking his neck and popping his left arm back into its socket. A few minutes later, they located the stairs and door, and walked out onto the street. Looking up, they saw the great gate close with a mighty boom. "Morn, what's our status?" Wathin asked. "Too good," the Techmarine grumbled. "The enemy is pulling back, and Titan Agamemnon is intact, and mostly operational, although retrieving it from the sea may prove somewhat troublesome. I'm not going to jinx it again, but we both know that this was far too easy." "Agreed. This was their initial probe. They will return, or attempt some other scheme. Let us hope then that scheme involves fewer Titans. I do not care to try that again." Rural is a great app available on the Apple and Google Play Store as well as desktop for creating beautiful 8-bit character art. The app has 14 supported races, 150 plus weapons, 400 plus armor pieces for you to mix and match, 20 plus mini bases. There is that much to work from. I was able to make Coldsteel the Hedgehog, the God Emperor of Mankind, Pepe, and they are always adding more artwork. The app also has a character sheet to help keep track of everything during games. And if that wasn't enough, you can play about with the app for free with limited artwork. So go ahead, check it out, and if you decide to buy the app, use promo code NICKBEARDIA for 10% off and it lets them know we sent you. It's a great sponsor and a great app and we hope you guys go ahead and check it. But let's get back to the video. Chapter 10, Sheep and Lions. Upon their glorious return to the rest of the kill team, Constantine and Wathin were immediately moved to a medici. The Emperor gave you brains. Morn grumbled at them. "So in the Omnigia's name, use them. Throwing yourselves off of a fortification onto a bio-titan is a monumentally foolish decision in so many different ways that I'd expect it from a hive noble with too many stories in his head, not Death Watch." Elsewhere, Andriel sneezed. "Well, it worked, and we aren't dead," Wathin countered. "So we aren't morons, we are innovative, brave, or some other nonsense propaganda word like that. What is the status of the other titan?" Constantine asked. "Still operational, just at the bottom of the ocean. Retrieval will not be swift. On the upside, all of their weapon systems are still fully operational, so they will no doubt provide support for the submarine effort," Morn reported, quoting a report verbatim. "This was still far too easy. They threw three bio-titans at us, along with over a million Lesizinos," Constantine grumbled, "while also attacking every other hive on the planet. It's possible that the Xeno simply overextended, trusting in its numbers alone." The three of them were now sat inside the Great Manufactorum. Or at least Constantine and Wathin were sitting. Their legs were suspended in large slings, their armor removed so that Morn could examine their injuries. It was not pretty. Their feet and lower legs were more bruised than anything else, and covered in clots from a dozen compound fractures. The damage would have been enough to cripple a mortal, and require their legs to be replaced, not that Morn hadn't considered that an option. Fortunately, these were a start, and their power armor had held their legs in one piece, allowing Morn to reset the bones. From there, a cocktail of painkillers, steroids, and other more obscure drugs in the Astart's own physiology would have the pair walking within a day, assuming the pair held still. Though they might actually have a day to recover. After the fall of the Bio-Titans, the Great Devourer had fallen back, and had not yet returned. Among the Guard, it was cause for celebration. Among the Death Watch, cause for greater concern. The Tyranid never retreated. They regrouped, they tried again. They would return, and in greater numbers. Morn and Worthen had discussed it, and concluded the Xeno would now refocus its efforts on the other hives, to claim their biomass and restore its strength before making another attempt. Word trickled in from the Void War. The move to deploy the Titans had been a risky one, and costly for both sides. They had forced an engagement from the Hive fleet, and brought it to battle. However, in order to secure a swift and by all accounts certainly perilous entry, many ships had been sacrificed. Their blood had been avenged threefold upon the Xeno, but that was still a losing trade. A prolonged engagement under such circumstances would have resulted in a Pyrrhic victory at best, with relief forces so depleted in strength that retaking the lost capital would be impossible. The Navy had pulled back, and engaged the Hive fleet at long range with lance weaponry, but the fleet escaped to the other side of the planet, vanishing among its rings. A Hive fleet, once dark, was nearly impossible to detect. Even when fully active, they propelled themselves slowly, with none of the vox chatter, internal energy, heat, and other such necessities that could be used to track any other form of ship. However, the biological ships of the Hive fleets had an even more insidious tactic. By entering into a sort of pseudo-hibernation, they could reduce their energy consumption and heat output even further, making them virtually undetectable by traditional means. Combined with their effect upon the warp, tracking down a hidden Hive fleet was a monumental effort in spite of their massive numbers. Needless to say, the Navy was frustrated. What was supposed to be a certain blow to break the fleet upon Alvara before it could threaten the rest of the sector was turning into a drawn-out game of cat and mouse. Meanwhile, the forces already on the planet grew, and pressured the Imperials ever further. The Tyranids knew that if it came down to a war of attrition, they would always win. All they had to do to secure victory was keep the pressure on, and keep the Imperium on the defensive. This left Morn equally frustrated as he departed the Medici facility. If they had the Titan and associated forces, perhaps a counter-thrust may have been possible. But the Titan was, for the moment, out of the picture, and its accompanying forces had been obliterated by the surprise arrival of the Bio-Titans. His fists clenched until they creaked from his anger, anger towards himself for not predicting this outcome, and anger at the Princeps for acting so recklessly with the counter-attack. He composed himself, and began to intake the data from the various reports. Casualty lists, ammunition expended, fortifications in need of repairs. It filtered through and he began to send out orders, directing labor, lasgans, power packs, and shells as best he was able. It was a meditative process, cold and data-driven. Even so, he felt the animal anger, the Wroth blood of Ferris coursing through his veins. He would stand. He would defend, he would do what was required of him. But it burned him to remain still while the enemy remained on the back foot. Now was the time to strike, but he was unable. His frustrations grew as his thoughts turned towards them, and he forced himself to regain his composure again. His irritation had affected the machine spirit of his mechatantrites, and they had begun to squirm and hiss. He took a deep breath, and put aside the reports for a moment. He walked along the edge of the great factory cathedral, and took a seat upon an iron pew. It creaked slightly beneath his weight. There for a moment, he paused and joined his voice to the Beneric choir, offering praise and prayer to the machine god, the Emperor, his father. Father. Grant me focus, and let cold logic overcome my wrath. Oh, how I yearn to bring destruction upon your enemies, upon the Xenos who defile your world. Yet do not let it blind me, for to go by fury alone is a path to defeat, if not damnation. Enlighten me, Omnisiac, to the secrets of the mechanical mind. Cleanse me from the temptations and passions of flesh, and elevate me to the purity of logic. O machine god, liberate my mind from this rotting cage of biomatter and animal instinct, and let your cold dispassion reign. Then he took the sacred oils, and performed the rites to atone before the machine spirits which upheld his form, and returned to his duty with renewed calm. Meanwhile, Aitra had left the battlefield, and the threats to her life had by no means diminished. Word had spread quickly of her actions, and of the temporary command Morn had bestowed upon her. But with Morn occupied with other matters, The question of where that command ended, or if it had ended, remained open. Not to say that the sergeant meant to keep her command. Quite frankly, she would have preferred to keep her head down, but irritated nobles will not be so easily dissuaded. So as she labored alongside the other members of her regiment to rebuild and repair the damage caused by the first attack, trouble found her. It came in the form of her erstwhile commander, along with two members of his personal squad. Sergeant Atra, step forth. He ordered. The goods woman sighed, put down the bag of permacrete mix, and stepped forwards, saluting sharply. Yes, sir. She responded. I am placing you under arrest, on two counts of cowardice, one count of impersonation of a commissar, and one count of improper dress. The lieutenant informed her, and nodded towards his men, who began to approach. Improper dress? Atra asked, flabbergasted. She had expected trouble from her brief command, but this was a shade ridiculous. Inwardly, she seethed. They were under attack by the Tyranids and had barely fended off their initial thrust, and here this fool was arresting her over improper dress. Yes, you received a temporary field promotion to captain, however you neglected to don the proper uniform, and therefore are subject to severe offense. Furthermore, you summarily executed a retreating guardsman, which is not within your authority, and thus committed a capital crime. As for cowardice, there are indeed reports of you fleeing from the vile Xenos, which resulted in the death of Special Weapons Squad 142. A. The lieutenant explained coldly. Consider yourself lucky we are bothering with the court-martial. Unlike you, we still have some respect for military tradition and proper procedure. If you were judging yourself, I have no doubt you would have been simply executed. His words were clipped, professional, and impartial, but his sneer was anything but. Atra still had her lasgun near to hand. Her eyes flicked briefly towards it. This fool, this utter baboon. She wasn't certain what a baboon was, but some expressions stand the test of time, even if their meaning does not. This sniveling blue blood had stood back away from the lines, so far that she had had to step up and do his job, and he had the gall to call her a coward. Had he even seen a hive tyrant? Don't. A voice filled her mind. Don't. Then space parted behind the officer, and Andriel stepped through. The man turned, alongside the command squad, who leveled their Helgans at the approaching figure, then very quickly set them aside. The Dark Angel approached, drawing very, very near to the officer, so that the differences between the two were painfully, horrifyingly obvious. Good day, Lieutenant Devoir. May I inquire as to what exactly you are doing? Devoir soiled himself, and Atra smirked. The Blue Bloods could do whatever they damned well pleased, but an angel cares nothing for the amount of thrones in a man's bank, or how long his bloodline ran. He stammered. No matter. I will find out. Andriel said quietly, and his staff gleamed slightly. Ah. He said, as he casually plucked the information from the officer's mind, as easily as a fish from a stall. I see. I will attend to this myself. As it was my battle brother who granted her the promotion, and ordered that she stand beside us at equerry. He informed the cowering noble. Hey, my lord, my sincere apologies, but there is so much to be done. I thought I would attend to it, so as to not waste your precious time. Devoir stammered. Indeed, there is a great deal to be done. So much paperwork, so much that even during a battle one must remain back to attend to it. Andriel replied diplomatically. So did go and attend to it. It would be a shame if you were not able to claim glory for yourself and your house, because such duties were not attended to in time. Devoir recognized an out when he saw it, and fled. Andriel watched him go, shaking his head. So much for the sword nobles. He muttered. Emperor forbid any of them have a clue what it truly means to serve. Thank you for the assistance, my lord. Atra told him, bowing low. I will not permit my battle brothers to have their honor tarnished, even if merely by the association with you. The Dark Angel replied. You will die, that much is certain. It is a shame, because you are a fine soldier, but you are mortal, and we are not. I will ensure that when you die, die with honor, so my brothers are not disgraced. Then he departed, leaving the Guards woman shaken. She returned to her work for the next few hours, but it was mindless, and there was little talk. Few could speak, as all labored, but even in the brief breaks to swig from a canteen, they avoided her. She was a dead woman walking, one way or another. Why bother speaking with her? It was almost a relief when her vox bead buzzed. Captain Atra, gather your squad. The enemy has revealed their hand. More Nord and her. Meet with us at Spira 51 floor 24. The targets are Jenna Steelers. Chapter 11, Changing of the Guard. The reports of Jenna Steelers in the Underhive did not come as a surprise to anyone who had ever faced the Tyranids before. In fact, the reason they knew of them was because Morn had made preparations for this exact eventuality. In consultation with Wathin, he had placed Ganger Militia, Arbites, and even a few Battle Servitor forces in the Underhive to act as a screen and early warning system. The information he was receiving now indicated that there was a substantial force down there, gathering itself together to strike when it received the signal. A decisive blow at this stage might be able to shatter their fledgling resistance, but they possessed certain advantages. Firstly, they were in the Underhive, which was trouble enough. The dumping ground of a hive city, running full of toxic disposals, mutants, heretics, and all manner of threats, was not an area easily penetrated. The environments down there were so deadly they were occasionally used to gather recruits for Space Marine chapters, most particularly the Imperial Fists and their successors. Constantine would be of no help in that particular matter though. Even if he had come from a hive world, it would have been long enough ago that his memories of the Underhives would have mostly faded. Even if they had remained, each hive was slightly different, but those slight differences could mean the difference between victory and catastrophe. Nonetheless, Morn began to assemble all data available on the movements of the Xenos hybrids and their location. Yet as he began to do so, a concerning pattern began to reveal itself. He cross-referenced this pattern with the overwhelming amount of data gathered in the battle, and nodded grimly. He then assembled the rest of the kill team and began to present his findings. 1132.34 hours. Astropath Lurua Gentles disappears. He began, then pointed to her last noted location on a map of the city. 1137.02. Battle Sicker C3-822 also vanishes. His corpse was found decapitated several levels down. He pointed to a nearby location. 1202.57. Battle Sicker C3-839 vanishes. Another decapitation. 1217.39. Astropath Clara Martel disappears. I suspect if we find her corpse, it will also be missing its head. Furthermore, at points here, 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 and here, sergeants assuming impromptu command went mere. I hypothesize these disappearances are the work of a lictor. Wathin sucked in air through his long teeth. You're probably right about that. Black Mane and Bloodied Hunter. He cursed, a fitting epithet considering his foe. That's going to be a problem. I note that it has not targeted any of the higher command staff. Constantine remarked wryly. Their uselessness is so apparent even the Xenos can perceive it. You might want to watch yourself, Andriel. It seems to like hunting witches. Ah, I see. Get one of your countless apothecaries here then. You may have found a new neophyte to train. Andriel replied with a faint grin, which grew only somewhat wider when he saw the Templar's face darken. You are correct. It is targeting Sickers with unusual frequency, and not engaging with command elements as is the usual pattern for this bioform. I wonder what it is up to. Firstly, the new neophyte is that Guard's woman of his. Wathin commented, to which Constantine groaned and put his head in his hand. By the Emperor, you do all recall that bringing the mortal along was Morn's idea, correct? We have a duty to do. Let us attend to it without unnecessary humor. Bah, laugh while you can, lad, for tomorrow we may all be dead. Wathin said with proverbial intent, but a real edge underneath it. The old wolf was fond of joking, but there was a serious side to this jest. Wathin, if I recall correctly, you and Constantine managed to kill a Bio Titan, which is why you are still here. Eishvan mentioned. They were, of course, still in the infirmary as the Titan Slayers recovered from their adventure. If nothing else, I am confident you will devise some equally cunning and equally insane plan to deal with this lictor. Wathin grinned as wolfishly as one would expect him to, but it quickly faded. Neither of you two young bloods have faced a lictor before, have you? It is Azino, we are Death Watch. And we have the blessing of the Emperor. We will kill it. Constantine asserted confidently. I'm surprised to see you optimistic about anything, brother, but I concur. This is what we were chosen for. Eishvan said in agreement. I would advise you both to review your training on this particular form of Xenos, and check your excitement. Overconfidence is a slow and insidious killer. Morn reminded them coldly. Regardless, we will not be able to engage it until Constantine and Wathin have both recovered, so not for. There was a slight pause as he ran calculations. Another 6 hours, 32 minutes, and 18 seconds. Do not attempt to engage it yourself, it will kill you. Constantine's eyes narrowed, but he nodded. Watch yourself then, Andriel. As said, it hunts sickers. His voice was cold, but not contemptuous. He had accepted the threat, and while he detested the witch, to fall to a single Xeno would not be a worthy death even for a cursed warrior. Andriel nodded. As we will not be engaging it directly for some time, I will move to the Astropathic Choir. I may be able to conceal their powers and keep the enemy from engaging them for a time. That leaves only the small, original problem of the Genestealers festering in the Underhive. Eishvan noted. We shall have to call on the Mortal Defenders again. Morn nodded. I concur. If not for the presence of the Lictor, I would have waited for these two to recover and then we would have led them directly, but as it stands we are most needed to eliminate this threat. Therefore, I shall have to accelerate my schedule. Eishvan, you have faced the enemy in similar conditions, fighting within the gate, and your chapter has a greater understanding of mortals and urban combat than mine. I would benefit from your assistance in directing our strategy. Gladly, brother. Eishvan replied. And I will gladly assist the new mortal command staff also. Morn nodded, pleased that the salamander understood his intentions. Within a few hours, he gathered together the full command staff in a great conference room. He had not informed them of the purpose of the meeting, but they came nonetheless. His heightened senses could smell the sweat of their fare. He was no space wolf, but they were obviously frightened. So he began to speak. You are failures. You have failed the Emperor, you have failed the Imperium, and you have failed your city. He judged them coldly. You are primarily cowards, having attained your rank by familiar connections and politics. You are weak, unwilling to face the enemy when it is at your very gates. You are fools, thinking that you can save your own lives even while endangering the city. Do you think that you will negotiate with the Xenos? These are not Tau who will bring you into their fold because of your thrones. Not that you would have survived the wrath the Emperor would bring down on you for such a betrayal. You risk one of the most important worlds in the sector, and worse still, an STC fragment and an entire Titan Legion which has been deployed to save your ungrateful bodies. You are weak. A weakness in this city that will poison it and see it destroyed. Such weakness shall not be permitted. With that pronouncement of judgment, Morn raised his bolt as swifter than a mortal eye could follow, and executed a preset firing protocol. In less than 5 seconds, all but 6 of the mortals were dead, the patter of exploded skulls still faintly pattering to the ground. The 6 survivors stood in shocked silence for a moment, before one drew a LAS pistol from his hip and placed it to the side of his temple. Morn's bolt roared once more, and the pistol flew from his hand in several pieces. The bolt shell impacted the wall behind the officer and exploded, showering him in dust and leaving a ringing in his ears. As for the rest of you, you possess potential. However, your records indicate that you are as of yet unworthy of your current positions. Nonetheless, you have demonstrated courage and loyalty in the face of danger, and also possess the training in the theories of warfare needed to complement the direct experience of your new superiors. You will each serve as an adjutant, and have been selected to survive and fulfill this duty because you will serve loyally and with all courage. And, he added, noting the corpses of the former officer corps, You are very keenly aware of the consequences of treachery and failure. You will find your new assignments at the door. Dismissed. The shell-shocked officers nodded slowly, and then equally slowly turned and walked to the door. Within the hour, Aitra received new word. A pale, nervous man in an officer's coat approached her carefully. A bandage was wrapped about his head, fresh with blood. Captain Aitra, I am here to inform you that you have been permanently promoted, as the prior captain and the colonel have been dismissed from duty. At this, there was a great cheer from among the common soldiery, for the high officers were much detested for their cowardice and cruelty. Aitra did not cheer, for while she was every bit as happy that the old officers were gone, that did not mean she wanted their job. Her previous command, while successful in its mission, had suffered heavy casualties. She likewise had training neither in the convoluted politics of the guard officers, nor experience in commanding large formations for more than a brief time. She consoled herself with the fact that while the times had called for her of all people to be elevated, she was at least not a colonel. Understood. Who is my new superior officer? It appears Lord Morn has not appointed any as of yet, and will be maintaining that duty himself. The man admitted. Ah, apologies. I am Cap. That is, Lieutenant Matthias. I have been assigned to act as your adjutant and tactical advisor to help you acclimate your new command. Matthias, you commanded the second. Aitra noted in surprise, before watching the man's face flinch and checking herself. He had been demoted. Well, at least he was alive. I've heard quite a good deal about you. I'm glad to have you on staff. Follow me, we should discuss a few things. Aitra quickly led him away, attempting to look like an officer, or at the very least like she wasn't panicking. Once they were alone, she turned and sighed heavily. Look, I am sorry you were assigned to me, as you are going to unfortunately be the one handling a lot of the work, as I have no idea what the feth I am doing. The Astarte seem to like me, and far as I can tell, that's the only reason I'm still alive and have this now. I'm not an officer, I haven't been to the Scholastica, I don't know the politics or protocol or grand strategy, I just lead my squad and try to keep people from dying unnecessarily. I'm fine on the battlefield, but for the Emperor's sake, please do not put me in front of a stratagem table, because I would like to avoid being shot by my own side for incompetence. They know. That's why they sent me, I suppose. I'm something of the opposite, I'm quite well versed in the theoretical but rubbish on the field. Matthias admitted. He spoke with a posh upper spire accent that was at once charming and infuriating. Look, I just watched Morn execute the entire bloody command staff for cowardice, and the only reason I didn't get shot was because I was at the front lines during the attack, mostly just trying to not get eaten. I don't know what I'm doing once the fight starts, and you don't know what you're doing off the field. Let's work together and maybe, just maybe, we can do our duty and only get shot at by one side. He what? Aitra said, jaw dropping. Wait, it's Morn. Of course he did. Blood of Sanguinius, or Ferris Manus as the case may be. Matthias nodded. He had good reason, mind you. The old staff were completely naff at everything except giving themselves medals. Though I wonder what his process was for picking new staff, well, besides you. Aitra just sighed and put her head in her hands. I honestly can't tell if they're trying to get me killed or not. First the moral assignment at the front lines, and now they're promoting me right after they killed the dastard who held the position before. Though as for the rest, he's probably read through the files on every soldier in the regiment and picked out the ones he's liked. Oh, the news gets better, or worse. Guess what our first orders are? He asked her. Clearing the bloody genestealers out of the underhive. Oh, by the Emperor, why? Aitra growled. Bah, well, best we get to work figuring how we're going to do this. Get me whatever maps we have on our assigned area and see if you can find me any gang of leaders and an Arbites who knows the area. She said, cracking her neck. You have a plan already? Matthias asked, mildly impressed. No, but if you want to make a plan, you get all the information you can, and all the experts you can first, or else you may as well not. She growled. Matthias smiled. She might not think she was suited for command, but she had a certain talent for it, and the humility that the other officers had lacked. She had an odd kind of potential, so he saluted sharply. "Yes, ma'am," he reported sharply, turned to go, and paused. "Ah, you'll be needing this," he said, turning and presenting a small golden aquila. Afraid times belay the usual pomp and ceremony. Aitra took it, and considered it for a long moment. An officer's aquila. It was heavier than its size would indicate, and vaguely warm to the touch. Then again it was made of gold, though she swore she could feel some arcane technology buzzing within. "You'll need it. It saved my life more than once during the last attack." Aitra looked at him curiously, but attached it to her breast regardless. Perhaps there was something strange in the little golden bird, or perhaps it was as Aishvin was fond of saying. The Emperor protects. Well guys, hope you enjoy today's video. We are going to assume you have if you have stayed to the end. Consider subscribing and clicking the notification bell if you really enjoyed it to stay up to speed with any and all new videos. Also check out the links below to our shop for some fat ass titties and our sponsor Rural, and be sure to use a promo code at checkout so they know we sent you and you'll get 10% off. And until next time. Time.